is July 14th. This is the planning board meeting study session.
Or is it a study session, or is it a full-blown meeting?
It is a study session.
Study session.
Oh, it is a study, okay. Thank you.
Board member Bolt. Board member Duzan. Board member Elrod.
Present.
Board member Graham.
Here.
Board member Moore.
Here.
Board member Runicki.
Here.
Board member Samuelson.
Here.
Board member Miles.
Here.
Board member Schrader.
Here.
We have a quorum.
Thank you.
And just to reflect, there are no meeting minutes from the last meeting since it was a study session.
Okay. Good. So the first is the approval of the agenda, which is in front of you. I think the topic tonight is going to be just a process and approach to the neighborhood plan. So Dennis is going to share that with us. And I also sent out to the group some thoughts that I had. And then if there's anyone from the public that wants to speak, we'll do that as well.
I did not get your thoughts.
I did not either.
You will get them tonight.
I got to read.
Dennis was, I maybe got sent out late or something.
Yeah, I didn't send them on, sorry.
Okay, so here they go.
Would you like me to send them out to the planning board members again?
Yeah, that'd be fine. Sorry, I went one way. So do I do public first, if anyone? No, not for a study session.
Do you have anything, Pam?
Pam, do you want to come up? Do you have anything?
It's not a public.
Not a public meeting? I'm sorry, let me ask a question. So is this a public meeting or not? So should I?
This is a public meeting. It is a study session. So it has a little different rules about that. And the board can, my understanding is the board can determine a time for public comment at the beginning or at the end, but not during the discussion itself. So your discussion should be just among the board, but there can be a time.
Okay.
And you get to decide which is more valuable. So.
Okay. I say we keep this a public meeting. I welcome the public to speak. So, Pam, if you'd like to, if you have any comments, you'd like to come up now instead of later.
Here's a microphone.
Does this one work?
Oh, I'll put that.
That might work. I don't know.
Thanks for letting me speak at a study session. I wanted to clarify, at your last meeting, I made a point of order to ask about public comments at study sessions and making a regularly scheduled meeting night into a study session, which usually doesn't include public comment on the agenda. And wanted to clarify my concerns about that issue. So a couple of years ago, a year and a half ago, during a scheduled hearing for Broadstone, a member of the public showed up to speak at what he thought was a public hearing. The hearing had been postponed, but he did not know that. He did not hear enough discussion by the board to understand that it had been postponed, and he shouted during the meeting. And I wrote email to the members of the board at that time to talk about allowing the public to speak sometimes, even when it's not part of the regular agenda, because it is functional and it is fundamentally good for a democracy sometimes. And in that situation, it may have diffused some anger, I think. So the other thing that I said in that email was that I thought it was very cool that our members of the planning board and city council help each other with matters of process. And it happens all the time. Chair, we need a second, and that is a great thing. I love that. So with that kind of idea in mind, I wanted to say that for me, you are representatives of the public. Some people think that when they're on a board, they're there to represent their own point of view. But we're a representative democracy, and I believe that members of the planning board are here to represent us. And I really appreciate it when you let us speak. And especially after a period of not having meetings during a time in Littleton's history when a lot is happening. The Urban Renewal Board is meeting. While I believe that there may be constraints about your discussion of the specific content of what the LIFT board is producing, you can certainly talk on a higher level about whether the process is proceeding as you'd like and whether you're learning things as it goes on. And so this is an important time to have meetings and public comment, and that's where I'm coming from. And so I really appreciate your allowing me to speak tonight and to explain those kind of ideas that I have about why it's important to me that you let us speak. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Pam. Okay. All right, we'll close the public meeting or comment time, and we'll start our study session. Dennis, do you want to share?
Great, thank you. Yeah, I think when we start a neighborhood planning process, it's always great to make sure we're on the same page in terms of what's the goal for this process? What are we trying to achieve? There are different things that we can look at in terms of achieving. One is we've got direction coming out of the citywide plan that needs some answers, more details. We've got several key issues that need to be taken up at the neighborhood level and giving us ideas. What they want. We've got a lot of kind of broad statements in the citywide plan. And when you look at the neighborhood plans, they have a lot of broad statements. Preserve the character, for example. Until you define what that character is, it's really hard to implement. So I think it's a great opportunity to get us farther along the road in terms of how do we implement not only the neighborhood plans, but the citywide plan, and actually get more details. Doesn't mean that we lose the flexibility, but we actually do start giving us a lot more information to work with, both at the board level and staff level. The second thing that we do is we give an opportunity to the neighborhoods too to get better organized, to find out who's there, what their issues are. If there's an opportunity for them to become more involved with the city, it's a great opportunity for them to get educated and informed in terms of what the issues are and really get into some detail in terms of what the city's dealing with at this point. When we look at what are the products that come out of the plan, it kind of aligns with that too in terms of an updated plan for each of the neighborhoods is the basic thing that we're looking at. With the current issues, current data, and a current set of goals and objectives in terms of what they want to achieve. Secondarily though, however, there's perhaps a new set of boundaries we might be looking at. There are a lot of, we don't know where this goes necessarily when we get into the real issue identification and discussion with the neighborhood as to how deep we want to go. So I think we need to leave some flexibility for ourselves in terms of what the process is, but while at the same time providing that overall framework for it. We've got a couple things that we look at. The primary thing for me is I think the citywide plan at this point and the need to provide additional data. One of the things we handed out when sent out was a list of the summarized goals and policies that were in the neighborhood plans. If you look at those and remember it was the neighborhood plan, it was the citywide plan, it's not addressing a lot of those things. I've got lots of paper for you tonight. First thing we hand out.
Can we get the red handout? You didn't make its way over.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, sure.
Blueprints?
We can do too, yes.
So the first thing I was looking at, do the neighborhood plan provide the detailed information that's
necessary to implement the citywide plan. And I went through and I looked at what's the direction from the citywide vision, what are the key elements coming out of that? And then I looked at what would be necessary to address the information in both the vision as well as the goals and policies. And I summarized that by going through all the neighborhood plans, and this is background information you may not want because it gets a lot more detailed. But I grouped them by category. I went through and said, okay, I don't care what neighborhood's coming from, this is dealing with character. This one's dealing with transportation specifically. And then from those, I was able to kind of summarize what they were saying. Because a lot of similarities among the different plans. At the same time, there was some distinction as well. So in some cases, it's my interpretation. And so if you have some time and want to do it, I'd always welcome you going through and doing your own interpretation too. I'm not sure we're exactly there where it needs to be. I think we're close. So I got the summary of what's in here, and that's what shows up on this first page. And it comes down to different categories, is the way I kind of looked at it. History, respect, and build upon the city's history. I mean, that was a theme that kind of ran throughout, you know, all the different neighborhood plans. Character, foster the city's small town, family-friendly character. Yeah, that's, we've got that in the citywide plan, the neighborhood plans have that as well. Talking more specifically about their neighborhood, but the city too. And so the question when we look at the city plan is, or the neighborhood plans is, what's your role in that as a neighborhood? You know, what do you define as in your neighborhood as the key elements that define that small town character? And then what are the challenges to that and what do we need to be doing? And how do those relate citywide? Are they the same that we're seeing every place else? And that's true for all of these. Diversity. Be home to people of all ages and backgrounds. That sounds very simple until you look at individual neighborhoods, which are primarily residential, and you say, okay, if we're going to be home to a diversity of people, do we concentrate, do we disperse, are there places in different neighborhoods, where do those people go? And so we start having to ask those hard questions of individual neighbors, and they have to have kind of a citywide perspective as well as their own perspective. Okay, what locations are appropriate for redevelopment, what locations are appropriate for perhaps more intense, a higher density residential, different type of residential, because we know we have demand citywide looking for, I want someone who wants the patio home so they can move out of their larger home and move into a smaller home. Well, where do we put those? Particularly when we have a demand that says, I want to be as close to my current home as possible. I want to be in my neighborhood. So we're going to have to put that challenge, I think, on the neighbors in terms of how do you do that? Where do you do that? So there's going to be a lot of locational stuff as well as just questions. Livability, value livability, diversity, and progress. Well, livability, what in the world is that? How do you define that? So what this leads to, I think, is that when we get into all of these things, we can start thinking almost in terms of a questionnaire. It's a survey that it gives us a set of questions that we need to be asking consistently throughout the city. And the good news on that is I think that's something we could do online, something we could do at a neighborhood meeting, it's something we can do in every avenue that we have if we have the same set of questions we're asking. And we can then identify where the response is coming from our neighborhood, and we can actually say, okay, here's an opportunity for us. That doesn't cut out the neighborhood planning process where we actually go to the meetings, but certainly gives a lot of background information and provides an opportunity for people who may not want to come to the meetings or be able to come to the meetings to get involved in the process as well. And I think that's one of the things I want to check with you. When you look at that top line of issues and direction from the citywide vision, those, I think it's 13 things, does that look, am I it's the right list? Am I missing something? It seems absolutely key coming out of the citywide plan that we need to be looking at. This is all also dependent upon the fact that we know that when we get out of the process, individual neighbors are going to have issues that we haven't anticipated citywide. So we need to be able to accommodate those as well for individual neighborhoods, but it doesn't discount.
There's a tone here that just bothers me a little bit, and I don't think I'm going to be able to articulate it very well, but you're asking what the neighborhoods can do to help the city, and I always think in the reverse.
Right.
What can the city do for me and protect me as my neighborhood?
Right.
And And I'll be specific when I talk about diversity, or number three, citywide vision, be home to people of all ages and backgrounds. Under the neighborhood, identify how and where each neighborhood can accommodate a diversity of residents. I went back and read every neighborhood plan, and probably 8 out of the 9 neighborhoods would say keep single family or whatever is the Absolutely. Predominant residential, keep
yeah.
it.
Yeah.
And then I also look at the zoning code, which is specific for what can be done, keeping me from subdividing my particular Aberdeen lot to a high rise, that prevents me to do it.
Right.
So the tone here is, you know, what can I do for the city? What can the city do for me? I get, you know, so it, right. this the diversity, you know, just one example bothers me somewhat.
Okay, and I guess I think it's the perfect discussion to have, because I think that's going to be the conflict and the tension we're going to have throughout this thing. Is it, in my mind, that you do both, you try and do both with the neighborhood planning process. When we did the neighborhood plans in 81 on, they really were done from the bottom up. They were done by individual neighbors, and then they tried. And then they came back and later did citywide, you know, issues and goals too. But it seems like we've got enough direction that we know kind of what the city is looking at. And if you don't get out to the neighborhoods, and you don't have that kind of hard question and put that challenge to them, you never have any diversity in the city. You know, who's going to take it? You never have any higher density. You know, when you get to the neighbors, they may say, it goes on my edge, it goes over there, it goes somewhere else. But at least it has to be a question that has to be posed.
Well, it has to be posed.
Right. Yeah.
But not imposed.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. Absolutely. Right. Yeah.
So.
And I don't get that. I don't get that tone from
okay.
reading your list here.
Okay.
So I think I'm sensing the same thing. Like I'm reading this as every neighborhood should meet each of these criterias, and I don't think that should, first of all, I don't think it's realistic, and therefore it shouldn't be the case. But I think overall, though, we are the reason for the citywide plan is that as we put all the neighborhoods together, we have achieved this citywide vision. We do have diversity in areas. We have character in some areas, and we may not have it in other areas. So I think it's important, maybe this is the approach, it's let's understand what each neighborhood brings to the mix, and at the end, let's look at it and have we achieved our citywide goal, of citywide plan, and if we have not, then that's where we relook and say, where are there those opportunities that we have missed? And maybe, who knows, some of those opportunities may come through annexation, right? So I think it's, you know, let the neighborhoods develop and let's work with the neighborhoods to understand what they define as, yes, this is character for me, or yes, diversity is what we should have in our neighborhood for whatever reason. And I don't think it's just the public. I think, you know, the individuals, there's businesses and other types of association and organizations that would feed into that process.
Maybe one neighborhood is, you're trying for a goal of 7. One neighborhood's a 1, another neighborhood is a 9, another's 3, another 6. It all blends together, and maybe you don't get the 7, you get a 6.5, and everybody's happy. So I don't think that every neighborhood's going to conform to that goal.
A lot of them cannot.
And should not.
But I think everybody needs to be thinking about it, and because otherwise we're not going to have any neighborhood step up and say, yeah, I want that. You know, it just doesn't happen typically. So it needs to be something that is put out there. And realistically, you know, not everybody can do it or will do it. But it's something we need to think about, because we do have that direction, and it was our vision for the city. And it is the goal that the city council has been putting up as their vision as well.
I have one more comment on this.
Okay.
So the area from history to sustainability, mm-hmm. I can relatively easily cross-reference it to the vision statements
okay.
here.
Mm-hmm.
And what I'm cautious of is introducing more terminology and more terminology. And we have so much that we've already done here and put a lot of thought and for and very deliberate about the words we chose here. So when we get to direction from citywide goals and policies, mixed use, alternative housing buffer, I think you're combining, you're trying, to me, it seems like you're trying to summarize some of this.
It's this thing where I summarize the categories. You're right. That's absolutely what it is.
And I think it introduces some other heading that we need to, you know, develop some matrix to come back to this. And I guess the question I would ask is why not use what we have, which are our goals, is an outdoor Littleton or dynamic Littleton. So I'm not clear of the purpose of this second section here and how we're intending to use it.
When you get down to the bottom column, the second row, excuse me, it gets into the questions I think
I'm talking about the columns.
Right. The columns continue down through the second row as well.
Yeah.
So the second column. And what it does is it kind of brings up the big questions, to me at least. If we've got mixed use appearing all through the plan, I mean, it's not necessarily a heading that we have for one of our primary goals, but it does appear throughout in alternative housing and buffer. These seem to be the big things that we don't have answers for. And so that's kind of where that was coming from. These are the issues. And again, like I said, this is my take on it, so I really appreciate everybody else's input in terms of what am I missing, what am I getting wrong. But the second row is kind of the questions. What are the challenges for the neighbor plans? If we're talking about history, well, tell me what's historic, what do we keep? What's important to you? If we lose it and it's gone, are you going to miss it? Tell us that stuff. If we're talking about character, let's identify for each neighborhood. What is the character? How do you define your character? Not just single family houses, it's more than that too. It gets not just physical, it gets into the cultural stuff too. But I understand, I hear what you're saying, and I think that's something we should be looking at.
I think we're jumping to it too quickly. If this is kind of the beginning, I think we jump to it too quickly. Okay. I think it's, let's identify what neighborhoods there's an expectation that it should be dynamic, and therefore dynamic may include and likely will include mixed use. So I think it's introducing it too early.
Okay. This next set, what I've got in here, I'll keep going with this. went through each of the neighbor plans with, again, the information that, the summary of the categories I took out of both the vision statement and also the goals and policies, and said, okay, do they address this in any form? Do they give us any direction for what we're seeing? So that's what you see on the rest of the pages. Where you see an X is where there is some indication in that goal that it responds, and that policy responds to what was in the citywide vision. And also what I was seeing is the categorization of the primary issues. And what you'll see is that, I think livability, it comes out first and foremost. How do we define that? What is that? But we just talk about it all the time, directly or indirectly. We're protecting our livability, we're enhancing our livability, and what does that mean? And again, I think going out to the neighborhoods, it's a great opportunity for us to help define that a little bit. So, you go through page to page. Character is the other, of course. Character probably comes in second in terms of showing up over and over again in these different goals and policies. The goals and policies, and I guess it's policies in this case that I have crossed out, are ones that I'm interpreting as has-beens, basically. They're ones that we really have no reason to discuss having Windermere go through or Gallup go through, for example, at this point. Now, when we've gone out to the neighborhoods for the council outreach, we've had people disagreeing with that, saying, I think we should still discuss a better way to get to the high school because it's causing a problem in heritage neighborhoods. So is there another way to open up? People who are still interested in opening up Ridge Road back to Santa Fe. So despite the fact that I think a lot of us think that those are things that have been decided and we've moved on, there are still people that think, well, we want to talk about it again.
Don't you think the people in those neighborhoods that have made that decision, though?
These
are people that are outside that neighborhood that want to get through there.
Typically, I think so. Because I think those discussions have been had and they've been pretty emotional and pretty intense, and I think this is pretty clear. Ridge Road is not going through, and Windermere and Gallup are not going through, but there are a couple others in here that talk about issues that are really far gone, closing the sewage treatment plant, for example.
What if we have a, you know, 200 neighbors from that area saying Gallup should go through?
Yeah.
And that's part of, that's what they want in their neighborhood plan.
Then we've got it.
Then we still have it, I suppose.
Right. Or look at alternatives to it. What's that mean? You know, why do you want it to go through? And I think our job then is to say, okay, let's step back from Gallup go through, which is the solution, and find out, you know, what are the issues, and then how do we, yeah, what alternatives do we have, so.
But again, you gotta be careful, you're coming from the city's viewpoint.
Right.
If the citizens want it, it's their neighborhood plan, it's not your job to
talk
them out of it.
I think that's a discussion we need to have, and Corinna sounds, she agrees with you. My experience has been that you've gotta go to the neighbors with a fairly clear vision of what you want from the city standpoint. What do you need from the planning board? What kind of direction do you think you need from the neighborhood? If you just go to the neighborhood, it's not gonna give you the information that you want necessarily. And I think we found that, you know, already with the community outreach, the kind of comments we've been getting in terms of key issues aren't what you're looking for, probably. It's very short-term, typically, is what we've been hearing to date. We've only had two meetings, but that's what we've been hearing, I think, primarily.
Isn't it the city's role, though? I would say that if I was a Joe citizen and I was invited to one of these meetings and I actually attended, I'd be somewhat dumbfounded by what we were talking about. Just reading Pick Any Neighborhood goals and transportation policies and land use policies, all of a sudden I walk into this meeting and I'm pretty overwhelmed by just the general premise of what you're asking. Could you walk through kind of how these meetings can be facilitated in a way that that person can get over that initial hurdle? And hopefully, whoever did this 30 years ago had amazing patience in what they created.
Well, and that's the challenge, I think, is that these meetings can go on forever, and this process can go on forever, because it does require a lot of buy-in, does require a lot of information, does require a lot of people starting from not knowing a lot about the process or what the issues are to really getting very, you know, involved in it. And that can be time-consuming. So I think that's the challenge for the board and for us, is to figure out, without spending a huge amount of time getting exactly what you need and what the neighborhoods need from the planning process. And that goes back to that initial, you know, statement of mine, is what is the goal for the planning process? You know, what are we trying to achieve? How much of it is that balance between what education and also making sure the neighbors get what they need and the city gets what it needs? So.
I guess I would echo the concept that it feels very top-down to go. If the city would like to do something in my neighborhood, I would like to say something about that first and say, this is what I'd like to see in my neighborhood. I would prefer that to be a dialogue, I truly would.
Oh, yeah.
And I'm very reluctant to over-define an area or even to suggest an area without first listening to these neighborhoods. And I don't see anywhere in even the list of summarized neighborhood policies identify the wants and needs of the people who live there.
I think
we should write that.
You start off with that always. I think you start with the SWOT analysis is the easy way to do it. Yeah, and it works very well.
Right.
You ask people, you know, what are the strengths, what are the weaknesses in their neighborhood. And it's very clear when you get through that. I think you have a pretty good vision, you know, for what people think are the primary issues. What are the threats and opportunities? Yeah, all those things. So.
Does that belong here then?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, absolutely, yeah. It's not in here because this is not the process. Yeah, this is really just the background, so for what we're going to do. So, but you know, this is really saying, okay, coming from the city's perspective, this is what we're looking for. But I think that citizen input, the SWOT analysis, and the other details that go into that are always a given. And I'm sorry to, you know.
I would hope that, to yes and what you're saying, coming from the city's perspective, identifying the wants and needs of the people in the neighborhood is a primary priority.
Yep.
And I don't read that in the 1 through 15 that's provided here. I don't hear that tone or intent.
Very good. 1 through 15.
On your memorandum to planning board.
Oh, okay.
Summarizing what we're talking about and how we're talking about
it. Okay. Yeah, that's not what the intent of this was at all. So, yeah, this was really just, this is what came out of the plan itself, out of the neighborhood plans, in terms of what they saw. And the memo itself, yeah, it probably wasn't in the memo.
Well, it's, I mean, it's stated as, maybe this was the intent here. Number two says, identify an optimum neighborhood and city organizational structure and process to encourage citizen participation, Now, it specifies land use related decisions, but I think it's much broader than that. You kind of touch on it, but I think what we're trying to suggest here, what Andrew's suggesting is, that's the first thing. And I think it's just how we phrase or lack.
I think I tend to overemphasize that, just this part of it, because often this gets left behind. I think cities go out without knowing what they want from a process. And I think until we know what we want from the process, we can hear everything from the neighbors, and it may not go anywhere. Yeah, so.
That's too bad, though. We start the process, we go into the neighborhoods, we're going to get it, okay?
Oh, sure.
They're going to give us what they want us to hear as far as they know the neighborhoods. I don't know South Park. I don't know your neighborhood and your needs. Mm-hmm. So we better be open to it and not say, sorry, that doesn't conform needs of our comprehensive plan.
Oh, no, absolutely. You know, that's first and foremost, but this has got to be out here too. I mean, it really does. You need to think about, what do you guys want out of this? What does the city, what does the planning board need to hear? What kind of information you need? Because otherwise, you're only going to get from the neighborhood. And there have been too many neighborhood plans done that only do this side and don't do this side. And it just doesn't work in terms of implementation, because you're not going to get the information. We're not going to have the information we need when we go into reviewing development plans.
Well, how do we meld that? Well, how do we meld that is going to be, that'll be the key to making this work. Or not.
Right. Well, I don't want to spend time asserting that a neighborhood should have a certain characteristic if that neighborhood does not want that characteristic.
Oh, no, and this doesn't say that at all. This says, tell us what you want as a character. What
the city thinks that there should be high-density housing on the street. I would rather weigh the opinion of the guy who lives
here first. If you read this, it says identify key elements. Everything in here is saying the neighborhood is supposed to be identified. So this is the challenge for the neighborhood, to identify all these things, to define these things, because this is what the citywide plan is calling for, and then it's up to the neighborhood to identify what's that really mean. Give us the details. That make sense?
Am I seeing this right, that this is just a blueprint to make sure we don't miss anything? It doesn't necessarily mean that it has to happen.
Correct.
Let's just make sure we didn't gloss over.
Yeah, so this is the background work, just for the board to know what the citywide plan calls for. Also, we have information, from city council directions that they gave us in January. What are their priorities? What do they want to see out of the plan, too? So we've got all those things. And then the process is fairly standard for how you go out and do neighborhood plans.
This is a flexible tool. It's not
absolutely
rigid.
It's definitely flexible. I do think that, for the citywide plan to be really effective, the more information you get out of the neighborhood planning process, the better. Otherwise, you're without a lot of information. So you're having to make information guesses in terms of what does the neighborhood want for its character. Unless you think about that, that may not come out of the neighborhood planning process. So you need to kind of direct at least those questions and then open up the rest.
I guess if I could summarize for maybe this three.
Okay.
Just be careful of the tone. You'll go into that first meeting with the tone that I picked up in five.
Right.
Scanning is for 2 minutes.
Okay.
You're going to be in big trouble.
Oh, sure.
The meeting will be chaos, and you'll lose the crowd.
This is your working document. So this is what we're working with, and this is not going out to public in terms of the public meeting itself. The public meeting itself.
Pulled it up to the camera.
Oh, that's true. Well, anybody can see it who wants. But when we get to the public meetings, we're going to be looking at public input and the process and making it as effective as possible. Yeah, I've done enough neighborhood plans over the years. I've done 30 probably over the years. And you start with public process. But as I said, when you look at what's happened, it's often, what does the neighbor, what does the city need out of this thing? And you've got to be honest with the neighbors when you go there that, yes, we want to hear from you in terms of what your issues are, but we also have these things over here. You can't not say that from the very beginning. Yeah, okay.
I think this is excellent.
And Dennis, I want to clarify, because I heard two different things. But before I ask that question, so this to me, and I think this is what, Carrie, I think this is what you were saying as well, is this is data. This is a consolidation of the data that we have from neighborhood plans, citywide plans, and trying to put it in some sort of matrix that it can relate to each other. So this is data. This is not dictating a process or articulating a process.
Not at least.
So I think, okay. And then we need to talk about the process, because what I've heard you say is we have to define what does that process look like, but I also just heard you say it's a very standard process.
It there are standard things you need. You need data.
Okay.
You need some analysis. You need issue identification. But how you do it, and that's why I think it's important to have this stuff in mind, because this helps determine what the process is. What's going to work best for this need, as well as, you know, really getting out to neighbors as thoroughly as we possibly can.
For example, in a given neighborhood, if we already have a lot of information, we already have a lot of X's, that process may look different than a neighborhood that has nothing to start with, so we're creating it from scratch, so that, okay, so is that how you're thinking about these? Okay.
So with this in mind, I think it helps you kind of say, okay, well, what's going to work for getting this information as well as what we need from the neighbors themselves in terms of what they're independently, what are their issues. So.
Is there a plan to go to the neighborhoods to gather information?
That's our plan. We're really working with you guys to see what the timing on that is, how much, what your role is in that.
Are the neighborhoods going to change from what we have in the 19th?
Well, it's not, at the beginning it's not, but I think that's something that may come out of it, because I think one of the things that we want to do probably is if it becomes an issue, have them help us identify what the correct boundaries are. And we've had people already say, well, you know, things have changed in the South neighborhood, for example.
Yeah, my neighborhoods.
That makes no sense anymore.
Significantly different than it was.
The way things are developed, that boundary should be changed. That may not be a wholesale change in the neighborhoods.
But you may see cutting out pieces of this goes to its own.
Right, and you may want more neighborhoods, you may want fewer neighborhoods, you may want different names for the neighborhoods. You know, the neighborhoods may want different names. They don't, the South neighborhood may not identify itself as the South neighborhood. Yeah. So we need to really think about that. All that's open, I think, as you get into the process. I mean, what really do you want to do? But it's still really important to kind of know as you're going through it, you know, what are the key questions you're asking, and then you open up for all the other things. And when you do the SWOT analysis or something similar to that, the issue of identification, you know, that stuff comes up too, in terms of, you know, it's something we didn't anticipate at all, something that they is important to them at this point. Maybe a particular street issue, it may be, you know, something else, but there are some key things that will come up definitely. So.
One of the things that I think when I read this in some of these categories, that would help it, because I was a little bit confused when I was looking at that second row, because it seems to me you're looking for three pieces of data in there, and it's not reflected in each one of them. Some of them have this, but okay. It seems to me that you're looking for how does your neighborhood reflect this characteristic, whether it's history or character diversity. Mm-hmm. Then you're also looking to see, is there a need to improve this or augment this in the neighborhood? And then the last question is probably, do you see opportunities to do that, or what are your ideas for that? Mm-hmm. And that would answer some of the questions that I think go to the questions about, instead of dictating to it, mm-hmm. to a neighborhood, you need this, is just checking in to say, is that something you desire? And maybe give you an opportunity. I think the other issue you have is that people need to know what they value the most on those lists. And so that maybe that gives you a chance in asking those questions to even have people kind of either rate or somehow mark those things against each other in order to get an idea of what their values are, because you can't necessarily do all things at once either.
Yeah, absolutely. If you're interested, I do have this background material too that goes through all of the goals and policies and kind of groups them to get to the categories. And again, you may come up with a different category, a different definition of what it is. You do the same thing with this, but this is kind of a good way to do it, I think. And the other thought that I had is just in terms of we need to think about, you know, what is our schedule? I also want to talk about a little bit, I'm sorry, before I do that. Council direction. And I think you've all seen this, but this is basically the direction we got from council in January, and then the directions of the plan. And this shows up in the plan itself. But you may remember that they changed some of the priorities of the plan. And this is kind of what's coming out at this point. So when we went through the changes that the city council had, they changed the priorities and added two corridors, which we didn't have initially. And then they revised the map to include the mineral county line corridors. And again, we were looking at the corridor plans as something separate from this, from the neighborhood planning plans that we're doing. So that's a separate process that we're working And this kind of goes through, just a reminder what the status of the small area plans is and what the priority the council assigned to those.
Do we, or does council see those corridor plans being carved out from the neighborhoods and totally separate from the neighborhoods?
That was a discussion that they had, that's where they were going, was that there'd be strong lines.
Obviously, they overlap because you're butting up against them.
Well, yeah.
How do you separate?
I think we're going to have to deal with that a little bit, because I think practically we may find some overlap there. Yeah, you have to go beyond the corridor into the neighborhood, you know, a block or two at least, to kind of have a sense of what the transition is and how do you make the transition. Because that's what we're going to hear from the neighborhoods, I think, primarily, is those edge issues.
It's not the corridors, it's the rub areas between the corridor and the housing.
Yeah, exactly.
Always the hassle, always the fight.
Absolutely, yeah. I mean, I think we have another set of issues on the corridors themselves, you know, citywide issue, to what kind of land use do you put there, what's the intensity there? But definitely, yeah, the impact, or how do you define the impact and how do you mitigate that impact as much as possible for the neighbors? It gets into traffic, it gets into everything else, so.
The one concern I do remember hearing from one of the council members, I think it might have been Stallman, was, are we going to miss anything? So they wanted to make sure we didn't miss anything. So between the neighborhood, the corridor, the activity areas, that there wasn't a gap somewhere. So I do remember that concern. And I think, you know, I think we were very intentional to say, you know, corridors will overlap with neighborhood, or they butt up and the corridor will have an influence on that edge of the neighborhood, or that neighborhood will have an influence on that corridor. So I think there will be question raised on who takes priority in those cases, the corridor plan or the neighborhood plan. So I think that's where we're going to have to be ready for that.
When you say priority, what do you mean by priority?
So if the corridor plan says build a high rise here, but the neighborhood plan says don't, how do we manage that conflict?
Well, number one, we go look at our zoning code, and that'll take care of 95% of it.
But this is intended, our comprehensive plan overall, when we think about this truly more comprehensive, is to influence zoning. And if there is a need for change in zoning, that's another.
Influence but not change it, I would say.
No, agreed. But.
But I think you're right, Karina, exactly. I think that's where the rub comes, is how do you balance those two? Because you're definitely in conflicts between the two. Because they're going to have a different set of priorities, a different set of needs that, yeah, will conflict with one another. So it's a tough thing, and we need to figure out how do we do that. So we can think of specific areas, I think, that already have that concern. So, you know, there are areas along Broadway, you know, where we know there are issues. And how do we resolve those? It's tough. So it's not an easy thing to do.
Are there anything we can refer to that was done in the past, either here in Littleton or in other areas, or what best practices there are? But I think it's just something to be prepared for.
It is, absolutely. And there are no simple answers for this.
Right, right. I think it all depends on the situation.
Right.
Okay. Well, does the corridor plan leave ambiguity there? The corridor plan just goes its merry way, and the neighborhood plans go their merry way, and then we, 3 years down the road, we have a massive hearing with protest.
I think each of them at least needs to provide, you know, a process and set of, you know, what are our goals and what are our priorities here. You need to have something set up in terms of how you're going to resolve that battle if you can't resolve it at the time.
Well, I mean, these aren't in isolation either. Don't these corridors interact with the neighborhoods and really, to a great extent, connect the neighborhoods together?
Absolutely. You bet. They form the edges as well as the connections. You're absolutely correct. So, yeah. But, yeah, it's how it backs into the neighborhood is always the question. And if you go through the neighborhood plans, even the current ones, you're going to see an awful lot of issues about traffic. You know, traffic coming through the neighborhoods from somewhere.
So. Yeah, I mean, if we propose to widen Mineral to 6 lanes, that's going to be a huge impact.
Or if you decide not to widen them anymore and start having more traffic going through the neighborhoods, because Littleton Boulevard through downtown is backing up like crazy, it's not working well, what's the alternative? Well, there really isn't one at this point.
Don't leave work at 5 o'clock.
So I think one of the, you know, the point here is that when we're doing the public outreach for a neighborhood, that same public outreach happens for a corridor that involves that neighborhood that it affects. So that they are able to contribute to the corridor plan as well as their particular neighborhood plan, and, you know, be aware of that from the beginning and be more of a part of that process. It may not result in exactly what that they want, but I think being part of the process from the beginning helps defray some of that. Some will just naturally exist, and then that becomes, I think, something we work through when a development comes in front of us. So I think that's what we have to think about, is if something comes in front of us, what do we follow, the guidance from the corridor or the guidance from the neighborhood? We kind of faced a little bit of that with the Stern Park. We should maybe get some legal or some counsel on, you know, future planners that are going to have to face this. How do they manage the two plans that may be in conflict? Or maybe we have to design them that they're not in conflict and make that decision now.
I think that's definitely the
one. Yeah.
I think the latter. We've got to resolve the conflict.
Resolve the conflict now.
Yeah. Or at least provide a mechanism for resolving it.
Yep.
Ideally resolve it if possibly can. Kind of set those boundaries. Neighborhood plans now have boundaries that are pretty clear. And they've been very effective in making decisions for what the land use is going to be. Properties in some of the neighborhoods that were really looking like they made a lot of sense for a little higher density, maybe townhouses. And the neighborhood plans were clear that wasn't going to happen. So, something to think about in terms of how much flexibility you want to leave in those neighborhood plans, or do you want them to be very definitive? Or do you want them to have, like we did with the downtown plan, we actually put in criteria for height. And here are the criteria you're going to look at for height, rather than having to make a specific decision for the height that's here or here. So you could do the same thing when it comes to land use or densities or something else. You know, you could think about the criteria for doing that, making those decisions on the corridor edge. We have another study session on the 28th, so we have an opportunity, I think, as a board to keep going. I want to talk a little bit about the role. What do you anticipate is the role of the planning board? What do you see as your role in this process? Because I know it's something you're very interested in doing. Do you see yourselves out there at the meetings, you know, doing presentations, doing more than that, doing some analysis, doing whatever might happen? It's certainly, realistically, you know, we'll do as much as we can, but we're also working on the corridor plans, and we're working on, you know, lots of other things that were priorities as well. And so there's just an awful lot coming forward at this point. And if we have a direction to do a certain amount of, you know, time, then we do have some issues. Yeah, Andrew.
Who's invited to these meetings? Is this just come one, come all, if you happen to live around here?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Is it targeted? Are we looking for a task force or a group or some coalition of people that would take some sort of responsibility or accountability towards getting this done?
It's a great question. Which way do you want to go? Because you can do it either way. You can do it either as just open-ended, or you can do task force. And there are pluses and minuses to both. The task force is pretty effective in terms of getting a group of people that have, you know, the opportunity to really get into great detail in terms of the research of what they're doing and getting to know the neighbors very well and knowing the issues very well. But at the same time, are they, you know, they have potentially not, you know, a charge of not being totally representative. You know, it depends on, you know, what happens. Whereas if you have open-ended meetings, it's going to be totally representative, but you may have people coming in and out of the meetings who don't have an opportunity to get as much information, don't have as much background as a task force would have, for example. So it's kind of balancing those two. I mean, we're open to either one. We can do both.
Can the city take an approach of something analogous to a bar napkin and just kind of say, these ones have HOAs, so the city's going to reach out to each HOA and ask for a representative. These areas don't have HOAs, so we're going to try to find a delegate from that area. And then, in more of a hybrid approach, have those people be assigned to a commission, or, you know, give them a gold star and a plaque.
Yeah, we have two.
But then also, yeah, still allow for open public discussion, but it creates an accountable audience, or at least a responsible audience, that you have to draw the ideas
from. And I would think we probably only have two neighborhoods that are completely represented by HOAs. I think the South neighborhood would be completely represented by HOAs. Although we have one that's yeah, Southbridge is voluntary, and it doesn't really exist.
Southbridge too is voluntary. There's a couple of others that are voluntary in Southbridge, right. So
they're not as effective as we would get in a place like South Park, neighborhood where they've got a mandatory, they've got monthly dues, they've got all that stuff.
Have ways to communicate with those people.
Right, absolutely. Yeah. So some we have some neighborhoods which have very strong HOAs and are well represented. We know who was on the board. Others are really just a name from an attorney on 17th Street. And then we have others that really aren't as strong as they might be.
At some point, I'm thinking pins on a map. If you have enough pins on the map that to a layman says there's good coverage here, then you have the right opinions. I just have significant concerns about going strictly the open meeting policy, because I think you're only going to get the kind of people who show up to public meetings. And I think we're missing a strong representation there.
And I think it's something you guys need to decide, which way you want to go. I agree. Pluses and minuses. Or you can do a lot more online, like we did with the Inspire program. And that was a fairly strong.
What kind of representation did you get from the neighborhoods from Inspire? Could you drill down to say from
we couldn't with
South area?
We could do, and they really couldn't with that one. They can do with the new one, and that's why they went with a different program. Because they can actually get down to very specific interests at this point. Figure out what's
if people
the closest we could get before was their pets. And that just doesn't
entire city.
Is it possible to have this hybrid approach of, the online and physical meetings? Because I think you got to make it easy for people, busy schedules, families.
Yeah.
And then you've got people that are more involved that want to be face-to-face. But I also worry about hidden agendas happening, a few speaking for the majority that may not be the case necessarily. So I think you need to check some balances, sort of.
Well, I think, question: what do you think about the Inspire process? Because we did both. We did the online. Few people were very involved, but we had an awful lot of people who were exposed, and so the numbers were good. We got 300 pages of comments from people that were good comments, they were very thoughtful, responses were thoughtful, so we had an awful lot of people, really good process, really good dialogue. And then at the public meetings, we didn't have as much, we had what, two people show up the first meeting, and they didn't live in Littleton, and then they started building over time, but you still don't get the numbers. Nor do you have the consistency.
Well, this is a neighborhood plan. You'll get right. Participation because it's their neighborhood, their plan. Okay, not the city's plan. It's their plan. Mm-hmm. So I want to throw it open to everyone, and I think it should be doable. It has to be online comments for those that can't make it, the elderly, too busy, three jobs, what have eight kids, what have you. Those that normally go to the meetings, it has to be open. So for meetings and online. It has to be open to, we never always bend over backwards to get the citizens to show up. We never invite the businessmen to show up. We've got to make it, especially in neighborhoods close to the corridor areas, we've got to get businessmen to show up. It's their neighborhood too. They own their store, they operate, they make a profit, make a loss, what have you.
And as you know, it's sometimes more difficult for the business people to show up just because their hours are different. So it's hard to get the representation. It does take a lot, almost a different mechanism.
So I think what this is one size doesn't fit all again. So if there is a particular neighborhood that we know is complex, there's a lot of business influence, there's a lot of individual influence, there's big corporate representation, that's a whole very different form of how we present, what kind of input we get versus a neighborhood that's strictly residential. So I think we have a lot of tools, and I don't think it's about using all those tools in every place. It's trying to determine what's most effective for each one so that we get the representation that we're seeking. And that, what I put together was the beginning of some of those thoughts, including the HOA, because when I got the email about today's meeting, it was, let's discuss the process. So I needed to wrap my head around what could this process look like, and it really is just some thoughts and ideas of how do we start moving, because it feels complicated, and maybe it's I'm making it more complicated than it is, but this was my way of trying to put thoughts on paper. Is this a good time for that?
I think it's a great time for it, yeah.
Okay.
Absolutely. It's kind of it's going to be iterative again, as everything else is going to come back.
Because some of the things that I heard were some of the things that I had captured, so mm-hmm. we can look at it and see, you know, what makes sense, maybe what doesn't.
Do you want to try and get on the projector with your...
If everyone has a copy, I can just go through it.
Great.
This is for example of the discussion. I did not do the whole list. And this is...
No longer the neighborhood.
These are made up words and made up, ideas and conclusions, but it's an approach. So what I really started with was, what is this process going to look like? I actually started with the end, which was, kind of your version of X's. I did that, and I said, wait a second, how do we get there to begin with? So I started looking at the process, and I took, for example, a couple of neighborhoods, took the priorities from the citywide plan. And what I was trying to actually represent here is priority doesn't necessarily, high priority doesn't always mean high effort, and low priority doesn't necessarily mean low effort. And so it's just a priority because there's either an urgent need there or whatever it might mean. So really, when you look at priority and effort, it doesn't always have to be, 3 months equals this. And again, I made up obviously the effort level. The other thing that I'll talk about for effort, then I'll come back to the process. Effort is not meant to say we start in January, we finish in March. Because we may start in January, things may happen, we may come back to it. But just as we look at overall, how much effort does this take? Maybe an equivalent of a 3-month effort. And we can, again, change how we want to define that, whether it's low, medium, or high. But I think we have to give ourselves some parameters to say, how do we commit ourselves to something and say, we have this on our agenda, this should only take this amount of time, and here's why it should only take this amount of time. Okay. So now I'll go back to the meat of it, which is the process. So I started with Progress Park, and I'll be the first to say, for a lot of these neighborhoods, I don't know as well as I probably should. But as I think about Progress Park, I call it multifaceted. So in this case, I feel potentially that the process may include an independent evaluation or an outside consultant, because there's a lot of pieces that need to come together in that area. There's, city staff, how is city staff going to manage that consultant potentially and review that comes out of there. There's an intensive public outreach with multiple constituents. Again, here's a situation where we're going to have to invest a lot of time, I think, ourselves as the planning board, as a city, because we are meeting with so many different groups, and so we need to be able to talk to them in different ways and present information to them in different ways. So this is where I think it's a significant need for this public outreach in probably multiple times. Versus something like Trailmark. Again, don't know that neighborhood very well. But here is a neighborhood that probably has a pretty well-established HOA. Right? Okay.
Yes, very.
And, maybe the level of effort is smaller because they're helping us. They're already representing, or they have forms that we can just kind of plug into. And so this might be easier. So again, here it's medium priority, but the effort is smaller because we have a concentrated audience and we know how to reach them, and we know that they're active. For Stern Park, I gave, so here I'm calling it engagement. So here, city staff is doing a lot of the planning from, we already have, I think a lot of this would be those neighborhoods where we have really well-established plans. But then we need to just represent, share, get some good focus groups in those neighborhoods, be able to really engage. So I think this is another process that requires a lot of engagement, but it's not as organized as the neighborhood focused, but there's still some maybe good chunks or blocks that we can congregate. Maybe it's, you know, there's a strong church environment in that particular neighborhood or a strong high school environment in that neighborhood. Something to think about, or property owners were the other ones there. The fourth category is social outreach. So I used Heritage here as an example. In Heritage, you know, again, primarily that is single family residential. It's, you know, just looking at the demographics of Heritage, you'll probably get a lot of social engagement. So here, you know, maybe our primary vehicle of getting public input is really focusing on social, and maybe there is less that we need to do on a public, like a true face-to-face. So maybe it's one or two meetings versus another one might be five or six. And then again, I use neighborhood focus again for Southwest as an example. So that was how I began to think about it, and this is where, you know, where I was saying it's not one size fits all, and let's define what the process should be. You know, let's come up with these names, if multifaceted works and neighborhood works, and then really define the process around neighborhood focus and determine what are the neighborhoods or corridors or activity areas that we're going to adopt that particular process. And that's how we begin to me at least, begin to kind of peel away at this onion that I think is pretty complex. Any comments or thoughts? And I applied the same logic to the corridors and the activity areas. Really, the only thing that I tweaked some words, and this was first draft and a couple of hours this afternoon. For example, county line, I'm calling it corridor focus instead of neighborhood focus, but it's the same thinking. The other reason I wanted to break that out, Dennis, as well, is we know that there are some areas that there is going to be funding for that an outside consultant's going to come in. So I think, you know, let's identify those up front. And I don't know how much we should really be getting involved now, because there's so much that they're going to do as part of the scope of their work. And so if we're paying someone to do it, let them do it. Let us come in at a later point in time, or at the right, let's determine at the right point in time, as opposed to us collectively, you know, doing so much legwork when someone else is there really that should be doing it.
In those corridor plans studies, will they do public outreach, or is this, so they will have some public outreach meetings, and so we would probably want to be at those meetings at the very least, taking notes
What I like about Karina's process breakdown is it pretty much says here's the arrows in the quiver. And to say that we have to fire them all for every single time, I think is ridiculous. But I really like the narrowing down of the approach based on who's our audience, who's our stakeholders, who are the people involved. And I would love to see us take that definition role a little further. And I think you've done a great job beginning this.
One of the things I see in that that I started to remark on is it seems like one of the questions that maybe comes up front in trying to figure that out as you look at neighborhoods is, are there places, are there community centers for any given neighborhood, or do people gather, and just trying to identify those to come up with what the plan is. I mean, as I say this, it's kind of a stab at trying to say, how would you do this in different areas? But that's something I don't understand for a lot of different places, but it seems like a key to try to gather people.
So are you saying, is the next question then where or?
Well, one of my questions I would start with, say I'm trying to come up with what the process is going to be for Progress Park, because as I see this is kind of an idea of what that could be, but it's not necessarily saying that's the final process, is saying, is trying to get some information on the community to say, where would we reach out to people? Are there places that people are gathering? You know, is it the schools? Is there, you know, church, community center? I don't know what those things are, and I think it's a harder, you know, maybe decades ago that would be easier in some of these places, but I think that would be a key thing to understanding how you connect with the neighborhoods a little bit is, are there ways that the communities gather? And maybe for some of them, that's going to be hard. Some of them, maybe the HOA, if you're down in a neighborhood that has a strong HOA.
I think one, and I'm just listening because I'm relatively new to this whole process, but identifying where the problems are, and maybe it's problems that you're aware of as the city or that the planning board is aware, or maybe that the neighborhood's aware of. Maybe it's their biggest issue is traffic. Maybe that's what the Heritage, you know, having the school right there, their biggest issue they deal with. So a lot of these variables they don't really care about, or they're not as important to them, but what is the most important thing or problem that their neighborhood deals with? And maybe that's what we can best help them with this process. Conversely, maybe the city is aware of, we've got a real crime problem, or there's, you know, major traffic congestion, or, you know, because of changes that have occurred over time, maybe it's the light rail corridor, these kind of things that we've seen this evolve as a problem. So trying to use this tool to help identify and fix some of that.
And I think, right, and also kind of anticipate where problems will be. It may not be there now, but I think as a board and a staff, but this may be an issue at some point. The other part of that, I think, is when we do something like the SWOT analysis, you also kind of force them to go to the flip side. They do the problem statement, but then they also have to go, what's going well? You know, what are our opportunities? So I think it's real important to think of issues not only just as negative, but also as positive. But you can actually have some issues out there that are really good for the neighborhood. We need to focus on those as well and how we take advantage of that. So, yeah, if you're absolutely right, I think you can kind of combine all that.
Thank you for bringing that up, because that was one of the points that I thought through as I was going through this, because the constituents to me, again, isn't just the individual in that neighborhood. It could be the city, as we think about city services and where, you know, where there may be opportunities. Trailmark has, you know, voiced concerns and a need for more city services in Progress Park. There's other issues here. So I think, again, constituents, I'm trying to, maybe even constituents not the right terminology, but it's a much broader net as we're getting input than just the individual person that's there.
Well, I think one example that I'm relatively familiar with is Norgren is a client of mine. And so you think of that Norgren area, there's a lot of multifamily, a lot of residential, not a lot of single family. So, you know, as we were talking about community centers, community meeting places, I'm like, there really isn't anything like that in that neighborhood. So there's no school.
There is now.
Is there?
Yeah.
So, that I'm aware of. So, you know, maybe as we do this process, we learn that some of these other communities have some of these things that are really the shining stars that make that community and neighborhood really great. And maybe that's what that neighborhood's lacking. So trying to identify those, you know, as you're pointing out.
I'm going to jump to the end just so I can at least complete what my thoughts were here and then maybe come back to this. So this last page then, so once, you know, we identify process or processes that we want to approach, really what we're trying to determine is, you know, I approached it from the goals, and whereas Dennis here, you went with a summary of the vision, and maybe there's, you know, we have to kind of find, you know, find the what's the thread that runs through it. So here, what I was looking at is how do I, let's look at a neighborhood. And this also speaks to, was in response to Randy's email saying, what's our role? How do we educate ourselves on something? So this was me as a starting point, but I think this could also be, you know, for the neighborhood discussion. If you were to look, if we were to, you know, bring Trailmark neighbors together and ask them, tell me how you see your neighborhood today meeting the needs of being a dynamic area or neighborhood. And I would say low. Outdoor, I would say probably high. Again, I don't know Trailmark very well, connected low. So this was just me independently, just to show it as an example. And this is, again, where then we talk about either problem or opportunity. So where, you know, Trailmark is low now, maybe that's okay. That's not a problem. So low doesn't necessarily mean that it's a problem. At the same time, when we say high, so let's use Stern Park High, dynamic because they have the Stern Park, there's lots of activities going on there, and the museum, the library, there is mixed use. But just because they're high today doesn't mean that they're done. We know there's still an opportunity to do some of that better, whether it's Market Littleton and especially the events that are going on in that area better. So this was an approach to how do we begin to categorize the different neighborhoods of where they are across the goals we're trying to achieve that we've outlined in the citywide plan today. Then the next step would be, where do we want to be? Are we okay where this is now? Or do we feel that some of these categories need to change, that maybe heritage should be more distinct? So that may dictate some architectural elements or preserving certain properties we hadn't considered before. I think actually a good example of that is the Littleton Boulevard Woodlawn area, where now mid-century has become the next architectural interesting properties, and that's where there's a lot of risk, and I don't know that we've given that enough credit, and where maybe more credit should be due. So this is how I began to identify where are we today, and then determine where we want to be, which would guide how the neighborhood plans should be designed. So they should incorporate, if a particular neighborhood needs to be more distinct, then let's make sure we incorporated that into that plan.
I think it's a great approach. I think it makes a lot of sense. I do think we need to think about it. Think about how you use the plans now for the decisions you're making. And I think this would be one good way to get there in terms of the detail you're looking for. But I think ultimately that's what the plans are for. They're for citizens to know what the direction is, for property owners to know what the direction is, and for you and City Council to know what your criteria are for reviewing anything or for doing anything, either proactively or reactively.
My assumption is that the process that we'll go through for each of the neighborhood plans is very similar to the process we went through in the citywide effort.
Right. Is there in terms of the big picture, yeah, absolutely. There's a lot of potential for moving things around to meet the needs of the individual neighborhoods.
But it won't be dialed back.
Sorry?
It won't be dialed back. If anything, it should be dialed up.
Right.
Into the level of specificity. We were painting with broad brushstrokes.
Absolutely.
On purpose, and had often said the detail is going to be here. Mm-hmm. How do we ensure the detail gets here?
Well, I think we have to at some point get down to asking them specifically, okay, if this is your goal, what's that mean? Tell us how you get there and how we define it. Whether we do it initially or we do it at the end of the process, that has to be in the back of, I think, all of our minds in terms of this has to be something you use, we use, and gives us direction. If it's so open for interpretation that we want a dynamic neighborhood, well, it's a great place to start, but how do you actually get there? What does that really mean?
I don't think you have any problem getting specifics when you're in the neighborhood. All my experience is sitting at meetings with individual neighborhoods. They're going to tell you almost over minutiae, the width of the sidewalks they want or something. Sure. Obviously, you got to dial back from that, but they're going to tell you exactly what they want in the neighborhood. Right. They'll get specifics. They're going to look at the flowery language of the citywide comprehensive plan and say, that's real nice, flowery, this now, boom, sure. This is what I want.
But it tends to be what's current, and I think our job is to pull them back and say, look at these other things too, because you may not be thinking about this right now, but you need to think about it in this direction in terms of, what do we do about this?
How far out is that expectation?
Realistically, probably 10 years, I think.
Or 19, 81.
Or 81, 30, 40 years. Yeah. But it should be 10.
So my effort's off? My level of effort's off? Everything's in months?
Can I just say something? I have to say, this is a curmudgeon. We were assuming that it was going to take X amount of time to do the citywide plan. I told people double that, and I was dead wrong. It tripled the time involved. This is going to take a lot longer than what we all think. Dig in, it's a long road.
Yeah.
is this a linear thing? Like, do we do one and get it done before we move on to the next? Because I'm looking like some of these corridor plans with the high, you know, needing updating, don't necessarily correspond with the neighborhoods that need high updating. So how does that look?
We really have to do, you're right, we have to, it overlap. It has to be overlapping because we do have a need to have those answers from multiple places. So there are some places that don't have as great a need at this point. You got, they're not going through huge changes. There's not a lot of issues coming before you,
right.
So you don't need direction. But there are other areas where you really need to make priority. And if we have to do them all at the same time, then we have to do as many as we can do. And that isn't all of them, unfortunately. But we have to figure out which are the top priorities to do, which neighborhood. And we may start a second neighborhood. The key thing, too, is you have to leave time for implementation of some of the stuff. You get recommendations coming out of the plan. You have to make sure that you've got time and we've got time to say, okay, we had this coming out that we really need to be doing. That may take time for the board and the staff to do it. So we have to, you know, build that into the process too. If you just go directly into the next plan and not, you know, leave time for everybody to actually implement, you know, we're kind of back in the same place.
I think another observation I think that is important is to make sure the right stakeholders are involved. So just to pick, for example, the Heritage neighborhood. I suspect much of what we'll learn from that process is that Heritage, you know, creates traffic issues, creates kids loitering, whatever, I don't know, I mean, whatever comes from that, but Heritage ought to hear that. Heritage High School ought to be part of that discussion and part of the solution. So, you know, when we're having those meetings, I don't know how you get somebody from Heritage there, but I think it's important to do that. If it's the Harlow Park area, then, you know, is that South Suburban, I'm presuming? So South, maybe South Suburban should hear some of the feedback that the neighborhood thinks about that part.
Absolutely, yeah, you're absolutely correct. And stakeholders, again, I mean, it kind of comes back to, do we do, you know, the steering committee, or do we do the outreach? And how do you guarantee that you have the stakeholders there? At what time are they there? So it's always kind of a good discussion during that, how you have them at the right moment so you get their input, as well as how they hear it.
So that goes to Karina's idea of the arrows in the quiver, of identify all the different categories of things we'd be looking for from a neighborhood plan, and then take action to get a representative who fits that demographic at that meeting.
And we may be surprised, and we need to bring somebody else in later too, but you're absolutely correct, we need to start with that.
And the last thing I'm gonna do is assert civil authority, but if the city were to say, in order for this plan to become a viable plan, it requires a representative from the school, a representative from the neighborhood, a representative from the community at large.
Right.
Otherwise, we will not consider that we have a quorum enough. There's something to that urgency and something of importance to the job title that I think would add credence to the process.
I think as well we're not going to have, you look at one neighborhood, you're not going to have a representative demographic from that neighborhood necessarily, even more so now than a few years ago, where you've got quite a range of people, not only who have been here for 40 years, but new people coming in, younger people coming in, families, singles. I think we're going to run into, in several of these neighborhoods, just complete polar opposites of what they want. I mean, Trailmark's a good example, or an easy example, because half the neighborhood wants a pool, half the neighborhood doesn't want a pool. And I mean, that's just a simple example, but there's gonna be lots of different things, and it's gonna be tough, I think, to put them all together in one.
Which brings up the other part that, you know, when we get to those kind of recommendations, city council's gonna say, oh, what's the physical implication of your recommendations. So yeah, what we have to be thinking about is the process. If we get neighbors that want certain things, we have to think about what does that mean financially for the city and how we do that.
As one of those in the stakeholder mix, it's the economic development parts of this that I don't traditionally think of when I think of the neighborhoods. I don't think of the businesses that I want to have. There's a 100% possibility that the market will change all of our ideas. If you know, huge developer says, I've got the perfect answer for the Santa Fe corridor, we're going to change our tune pretty fast. There's a chicken and the egg part of that conversation. entirely. Are there areas, and I think maybe this is where the high comes in, that are presently being identified to you by those who drive the market, whether they be real estate guys or business things, that could add urgency to our ability to get ahead of them so they don't have a blank slate and they do have some relevant guidance from us?
Yeah, I think you know what they are because you've been seeing them already. I mean, you have, certainly, the Mineral Light Rail Station, we're seeing activity at NSER, casinos, you know, the things that we keep hearing about. You know. There aren't that many locations around the city. We don't hear a lot about redevelopment at this point. I think if you look at downtown, we're starting to see, you know, properties being purchased to be scraped and redeveloped, and that's happening. I haven't seen anybody else, anyplace else yet, necessarily.
Well, I think that, to Carrie's question, I think that drives our decision-making. Mm-hmm. If it isn't a linear process and we have areas of greater urgency that need this stuff, then I think that has to trump everything else, as much as we'd like to improve in other areas.
We've kind of seen that already, I think, in terms of, you know, our priorities have changed over the last 5 years in terms of what neighborhood plans would come first, what small area plans would come, is it downtown or someplace else, just as the market was driving, you know, what's happening.
So a piece that's missing in this, and we kind of talked about it kind of on the peripherals, is roles and responsibility of staff, planning board, city council. And I think, again, I think what we need to determine as part of determining what the process is determine what the roles of the different groups are. Because in some areas there will be significant city staff involvement. In other areas, maybe it's to a lesser degree, and that's so, you know, again, if we're doing something like social outreach, it's gathering of data, and maybe that's something that, you know, I'll just say the planning board can use that more easily than, you know, the work that we would be needing from you. So I think there's, you know, trying to determine how do we stagger, not only based on urgency, but also who's involved. Because we may be sitting here, and we have been, right? I think we've had three opportunities for meetings that we did not have, but could those meetings have been productive meetings that we were, you know, again, if we had a process in place already, been getting that data, you know, sorting through it, debating what we had, what we see, and we make use of that time. So I think that's something that is, you know, we need to begin bringing together and define roles and responsibilities in each, as we define the process, determine what the roles and responsibilities are. And they don't have to be how they have been in the past. I think we can challenge ourselves on how do we do that differently.
Right.
And I think something else that was done in the past was a divide and conquer approach. So different board members tackle different neighborhoods or issues, et cetera, to be able to go deeper, be much more knowledgeable in that particular area. I don't think, I mean, for all of us to be, you know, knowledgeable for every single neighborhood at an extreme level of detail is very overwhelming, and I don't think it's necessary. I think that's what we're here to do, is to represent. So I think that might be an approach to,
you know, and I think there's some roles, too, that seem very appropriate. The public outreach part, where you actually help identify, you know, what are the avenues for each neighborhood. You know, who is out there? What churches are there? What clubs are there?
Sure.
Yeah, what social service agencies are in these neighborhoods? What HOAs are active? And who to talk to? So as much as possible, it's kind of, you know, your information. And then certainly as we get into more technical things too, a lot of you have some more technical expertise.
I'm thinking a little bit of preparation that the board can do before we start having these neighborhood meetings, whatever form that takes. But I could see each board member, whatever neighborhood they live, stand in front of this group and talk about their neighborhood for 5-10 minutes, give a history about it, what's important, what are the important issues that neighbor gets us primed a little bit. Also, we could have a little half-hour zoning study. What is the existing zoning of that particular neighborhood? We could also examine the 1981 comprehensive plan, what's still good, but to 90% of what's in there will be in the new one, especially the further you go into the neighborhood. So that little primer could get us going, and we'll have more information as, you know, as we sit into these meetings. And you had a question, a toss-up question about what is our role during these meetings, say if we have the free-for-all, come to the church, everybody in the neighborhood. In the past, we've been, most of the, I think the chair of the planning commission at the time would give a little introductory speech, introduce staff. Staff would be the proctor. Is that the right word?
Facilitator.
Sorry? Facilitator. Thank you. But planning board members would be there to, you know, catch the tenor of the meeting and at any rate go from there. So if we're going to free-for-all meeting, that's how I see it happening.
I think one thing, I can't remember who said it, but listening is a really important first step.
Going in and
listen and hear what these communities and these neighborhoods think are the great things about their neighborhood and, you know, what are the problems. And as we gather that information and we learn some things, arguably or hopefully, we've got kind of a bigger picture perspective relative to corridor influences. And then those overlapping areas where you're going to have conflicts. I mean, part of our, I view our job is to help educate. We first listen and learn, and then we educate everybody that here's the issue. This is how things are changing. And hopefully you get more buy-in in the process if they understand it better too. So I think that's part of what comes from this.
And Kurt has done a lot of that. I think Mark's done a lot of that too, just over the time, going out and just talking to people is exceedingly helpful, I think. It really is, just, you know, meeting one-on-one. For one thing, it's helpful the other way in terms of the public knowing that you're accessible and who you are. And it gives a lot more credibility to the word, I think, as well as just a lot more information. So yeah, it's really useful as much as you can be there. It's a lot to ask out because it's more demand on your time. But to be at some of the meetings, even for part of the time, is helpful. So can't be at the whole time. Maybe the beginning.
I don't know if we're looking for specific logistics tonight, but you know, there's 9 neighborhoods, there's 9 of us. I don't want to go into these things by myself. We partner up, and we each are responsible for 2. Mm-hmm. That seems manageable and enough that you can have some control over the specifics, you know, to report back and synthesize. So, I don't know if that's what we're doing here tonight. That's a thought.
As we go down that, and we can do that. What I do want to do is at least identify what is going to be sourced out, so we're not even talking about it, because those are complicated and we could spend the whole evening talking about those, and I don't think that we need to yet, because they're, again, going to be sourced out, and there'll be a whole different process that's designed around those that we could be a part of. So,
the first one that's going to be sourced out is the Mineral Light Rail Station, because we have a grant. The process of changing that, but initially we had downtown, Wolfram downtown station area as the first year, 2014, starting in October. And because of the activity at the mineral station, you're saying the market, you said it really would be good to flip that. Plus, we did the ULI technical advisory panel, and so there's some momentum. RTD has invested in the ULI tap, so they put money in, we put money in. So we've got some buy-in from RTD at this point, which is critical. IGA with them, we get the whole process. And so it's, yeah, that's federal dollars that we have through Dr. Cog and RTD, and there's, you know, a lot of paperwork with it. That's the first thing we'll be sourcing out is the Mineral Light Rail Station. The second would be,
I want to follow up on the first one. Karina, you had a comment maybe 20 minutes ago about how we would step back and not be in, did I hear you right, not be involved and let the outside pros do their job?
No, so what I'm not saying that we're not going to be involved.
I'm the exact opposite.
No.
We're in there from the start.
No, we'll be there for a second, but they're the ones that will be doing the analysis, the public outreach, etc. We will be a part of it, but we're not trying to define that process, design that process. We're going to work with them, but someone else is leading it. We don't have to lead it, is what I'm trying to say.
In the past, we have been an integral part, leaders, gappers, arguers. The Santa Fe Corridor Study was like that. The Planning Commission at the time was an integral part of that. Arguments repeatedly, discussions, refinement of the plan, charrettes, et cetera. So it wasn't just step back and let the, and I'm always afraid of the outside experts, you know, they come in for 3 weeks and they know Littleton. Sorry, they don't know Littleton. Mm-hmm. So in the past, we've been integral part. Now, that might change. We decide we want to be, you know, step back a hair, but I'd rather be a part of it.
You know, I guess my intent is definitely not to say that we're not going to be involved. I think it's too, again, it comes back to the roles and responsibility that we want to take in that process. And, you know, I refer to Dennis to say, who have we contracted for? How do we, how or can we involve ourselves in that process to make sure we guide that correctly? So, you know, I've heard multiple constituents being involved in that. So, I don't know how it was done in the past or what's already in progress now. I mean, there's things in progress now. I just don't want to spend time defining a process if someone else has already defined the process. If they've defined the process, we absolutely should be reviewing that and saying, yeah, that sounds spot on, or no way, you've got this missing, this missing, this missing. That's important to us.
Okay. Well, okay. They got to earn their salary somehow, and they'll come up with something we can
react
to, I guess, is what you're saying.
Yeah.
I have a question that I'm just thinking about that I don't think I quite understand. If we're doing this and we're saying this is kind of a process, it's linear, I think we said, where you're working on a couple of, say, the highest priority areas first, and then you're working your way through. Are we talking about gathering information for everybody right now? Or are we, because it seems to me that if you say, for example, Stern Park, where I live, is low priority, and you say, we're probably not going to get to that for a while, it didn't make any sense to me that we'd be putting effort into gathering information right now, because the character and the information you get if you're doing that 3 years from now may be radically different, and it's just no good.
No, I wouldn't think we would either, no.
Okay.
I think some of the stuff we'll have will come out, and we'll have it citywide, but that doesn't mean that we have to use it at this point. So. Some of those will change.
And it's these consultants that do a corridor study, will they have open meetings, several open meetings, numerous?
Yes.
And we can be a part of that or certainly sit in on those meetings.
Absolutely.
And then would we have an opportunity to meet with them before they've made their final decision?
They would do a presentation to you, I would think, at the end, and in terms of what we're seeing, what we heard, and your feedback on it, in the same meetings. And I think you've looked at what the schedule is and the process would be.
Because each of those corridor studies are adjacent to half a dozen different neighborhoods.
Right.
So they overlap and reflect what's going on in those neighborhoods.
Well, the reality is, I don't know how far we're going to get with the corridors, just because the money we have is relatively limited.
Can we get the cheapest consultants?
We can get the cheapest consultants. Go farther.
The Urban Land Institute came in and did the Mineral Light Rail Station. That's the second time they've done it in, 10 years. Whatever happened to the first one.
They did build on the first one.
Yeah, so. But they did it, and they presented it, and they talked to some stakeholders. But this is totally different.
Yes.
Any group, any consultant, like Civitas that did Santa Fe, downtown and Littleton Boulevard that worked with us, we were an integral part of that. Mm-hmm. And we approved the plan. We edited their work.
Mm-hmm. Which may need to be done again. I don't know where we'll go with that. But
Santa Fe Corps, English was not their first language in some of their verbiage.
Well, we would hope you wouldn't have to do that level of work.
It was pretty bad for a while there.
Really, it can be. It's amazing the time to what you get back from consultants.
Yeah.
Maybe cheaper is not better.
Cheaper is not.
What would you pay for? But just because I come back to low priority, so here's what I'm trying to get to. Even though it's a low priority, if we have a neighborhood plan that is already established from 1981, and the effort that it takes to update that one, because it's not complex, is it small constituents, or whatever it may be, again, trying to balance priority and effort. If it's a low effort, and again, it's going to be necessary to identify roles and responsibilities, because again, if we do something as a planning board, but then you can't tie it up in a knot, then it just sits there for 10 years, and that's not good either. But I don't want to, you know, just say, no, we don't focus on that because it's low effort. I still think we look at it and say, I think we're actually in a great place. The plan that's in place now seems to fit the characteristics, or it's what the neighborhood still wants. We can do some public outreach, which may just take a couple of meetings, and everyone's like, yep, spot on, looks great, et cetera, and we're done. And then, you know, at least we can check it off the list. Otherwise, those will never get done. It would be 2026, and we're still looking at a 1981 neighborhood plan. So at least we can say, we updated it, we looked at it, we gave it enough attention that we validated what was there, and at least it's more present, you know, it's more contemporary information.
There may be an argument for starting with one of the easy ones, just, yeah, just so we all get kind of our feet wet in terms of how this works and what we want to do, so, rather than starting with one of the more challenging ones. Okay. Although they may be very different processes, you're right.
And that's why I think, again, it comes back to what is the process, or the step, you know, this is where you said the standard part of it. There are some certain steps and that need to happen, and certain people have to be responsible for those. That's where we'll see where do we crash, or, you know, kind of run out of time or resources that we could take it this far, but then it sits there because, you know, that next step can't happen. So I think that's what we need to understand better.
Let me go through just kind of what the standard steps are. And there's a lot of flexibility in terms of how you do these, but you always do your data gathering first. It's partially issues, it's partially, you know, hard data. You know, what's out there, what is existing conditions, so that's what you're looking for. And then you do some analysis of that in terms of, you know, what does that really mean for us? And part of that, when you're doing the issues, you're also looking for what's the vision in some ways. You can do the vision fairly, we've done the vision, you know, with citywide. You know, we started early and then we kept modifying as we went. It was kind of a good format for us, kind of a framework in terms of, here's the vision for where we want to go for that. And it's good sometimes to start with that, even with the neighborhood plan, in terms of what does the neighborhood see as itself as? You know, what is it primarily residential? You know, there's some fairly basic things that can identify. You can sometimes then go through and say, okay, are there different alternatives for us? Sometimes there aren't. Sometimes it's just real, this is it. There may be alternatives for some of the details, but there aren't alternatives for the big picture. But it's at least a step you want to take and say, are there different ways to approach this? And then you start writing a draft in terms of here's what it means in terms of you go from issues to goals. And typically, okay, if this is the issue, it's kind of the flip side of it. You know, if you've got an issue that says we have a problem with, you know, our sidewalks, then you have a goal of having a better circulation system, including sidewalks and whatever it might be. And I'm always, I like as linear as you can get with that, more comfortable I am in terms of, I've got an issue now, I've got a goal. If I see a recommendation, a policy, and I don't know what the issue was, you know, it's kind of hard to say, did we achieve that? But you need to know what the issue is, and are we actually accomplishing that when we get through the end of the process. So to a degree, it's really important, I think, to go through and really be clear in terms of what are we dealing with, and know as you go through it, what's the process. And then you have to get into implementation, you know, how do we actually implement this? What does that mean in terms of structure, in terms of process, in terms of procedures and zoning and whatever it might be? Are there costs associated with what we want? If we want, you know, a playground, you know, in each of our parks, or if we want a swimming pool, an outdoor swimming pool, and in some ways we may think about that as a city, is that something to get? Because when you think about what's the competition for some of our neighborhoods, it's Highlands Ranch, which has swimming pools. Yeah, it has, you know, kind of the walk up. So we may think about it as we talk to the marketing people. What are we really looking for? So it's that kind of issue that comes up over time, and you kind of think, well, how do you actually do that? But what's the cost associated with it? What's realistic?
So you actually, just to make sure I understood that correctly, so you talk about implementation. Implementation does not become part of the neighborhood plan, but it's a consideration in defining the goals and policies.
And it can be actually, yeah, right. It can be part of the plan, but I tend to like it to not be too detailed because it changes so dramatically. Yeah, so it's kind of working knowledge, I think, you take through. And that's kind of it. It's fairly simple. You do issues, data gathering, and then you develop your goals, and then you develop your policies to how do you get to those goals, and how are you actually going to achieve that, and then how do you implement it. what's the process we take to do that? So there are really only a few steps. And then every variation possible in terms of how you get there. How do you get your data?
Yeah.
How much public outreach do you do? What, how much data do you need? Don't gather data you don't need. You know?
Right.
So it's gather only what you really need. Sometimes you do. It's a back and forth with your issue identification. If you have a new issue that comes up and you don't have data for it, you have to go get it. You have to do some anticipation with those data, what the issues are going to be, so you know what data is gathered.
How does Lyft, I think that's the new name for the Rivers Authority, how do they fit into our job? How do we play nice with them? What do we do?
It's potentially a great implementation tool. And so they got started early, I think, just so that's going to be in place. And what they're finding, yeah, I think why they did that was that they were finding discussions with developers and different businesses. The city doesn't have a lot to offer, you know, in terms of what other cities have, you know, financial tools. And so that does provide a lot of flexibility for them. So they've gone in and identified the areas. But the primary purpose for that is really to get the financial tools in place. And they'll focus on areas that are basically our act, you know, our corridors and our activity areas. So I don't think there'd be many surprises with where that is.
They will present to us or share their data with us.
They should be sharing. In fact, yeah, you guys are getting a presentation, I think, or you had a presentation from I guess not from them, but you should be getting one from them. As far as I know, I haven't talked to Glenn to see when that is, but you will be getting one from them.
Are any of our corridor studies being held up by what's going on with Lyft?
No, not at all.
Better not? Okay. It's not.
What was the question, Mark? I missed out. Are any of what?
I was just wondering if, we're looking at neighborhood plans where we maybe should be looking at corridor and activity centers. Question was, are we being held up doing that work because of what Lyft's doing? You're saying no.
No, we'll go forward, and they're really pretty. They come together at the end in terms of the implementation, but it really is a fairly separate process. It's a tool that I think can be considered in the planning, too, when we do the planning for Mineral Light Rail Station and also for downtown. Both station areas, we can think about those tools as possible.
Brought up economic considerations as well as
absolutely.
Market considerations, market driving.
Absolutely.
They can give us some.
Well, in the corridor studies, I don't know if you remember the applications we put in, we have to do a market study. They require you to do a market study for the areas you're looking at, so it's part of that. And then for downtown, they've been focused on what we do. So mineral is primarily urban design, land use. How does this really work? What's the structure? What's the finance? What are the financing tools that should be put in place? The financing mechanism that should be in place to make this whole thing work. So following up on what ULI did 5 years ago and what they've done this time in terms of direction, and the big direction, you've got to think of it as a whole. You can't think of it as individual sites. And you have to do it now. So this is kind of a response to that, flipping the two stationary plans around and doing them. Can't wait much longer. It'd be nice if we'd done it 5 years ago.
Yep.
But here we are.
We'd be all in place, ready to go.
Absolutely. I'm going to hand these out to you. More paper, just because we've got it, and you might be curious. And if you have, this is how I came up with the summaries, and kind of hear what I was seeing as the key thoughts. And please disagree when you look at this stuff and see, because it was really just, And again, this is just reading through the existing neighborhood plans and saying, okay, here's the what's this? We're seeing kind of something similar in each of the plans. So the plans are across the top, each of the neighborhoods, and then down at the bottom we've got the vision, the citywide, and the citywide goals. And then we get into each of the goals and policies from all the neighborhood plans. And I did these by subject, so by topic. So the other one we have is by neighborhood plan. What's in there? This one is looking at it the other way, how many of the plans are have something that they say about transportation. So that's what that one is. And I think it's useful to go through just to see what is in there. And just because there's a dot there doesn't mean that there's a lot of discussion. When you get in later, it's just what you'll find is that specific policy or goal appears only in one plan, but that's where they are. So you've got, this is where you had to read through all the plans. This is maybe an easy way to look at them, what's there now.
Could we possibly have a prologue to the neighborhood plans that summarizes the repetitive items that always come up in every, you know, in 1981, they'll come up this time around, like traffic through the neighborhood. It's, I mean, you could, like a two-page summary in the beginning, prologue.
Neighborhood character.
Might be. It might save some space later on. Yes.
So like a summary of the neighborhood? Is that what you're saying?
A summary of general concerns would be, I think, just a nice boiling down for those who just want a quick read on the neighborhoods. They could read that two-page summary.
If you say concerns, though, that already is, there's a conclusion there that these things are of concern, as opposed
to
a summary of...
Just concern or...
Status quo. A summary of the neighborhood. Okay.
Are you saying to put that into the plan or into what we present to the neighborhoods? I missed that part.
I'm thinking actually the plan itself. That's a possibility. Rather than just you go from the citywide plan and you dive right into the neighborhood plans. Well, there's a prologue, just as we have kind of like a one-page prologue to our citywide plan.
It almost becomes just part of that data gathering. It's a summary. It's a piece of data that summarizes.
Summary is the right word, yeah.
If this makes sense, I think one thing I might do for the next meeting is actually put together just a kind of sample survey that we would include, you know, online, might have for meetings, and it's just something that I can to talk about and just kind of start.
Dennis, you know, I feel like we're jumping to one particular process, like we'll do a survey, and I really feel that we need to, I feel pretty strongly that we need to identify what the holistic process can be, you know, something to what I recommended or that with a lot of the input that came in here, so that then again, we don't just do one survey that's not based on any particular process, and it may not be asking the right questions, or it may not be positioning those questions the right way, because again, the way you position the question to a business may be different than the way you position the question to an individual. So I feel like that's like jumping ahead. And I do want us to be very clear. It's still not clear to me what the process is. We had a lot of discussion, but I think we have to be clear of what the process is so that we can all know where we need to start running, walking, or just crawling.
The next meeting, we can refine that and just finalize what the process is.
Maybe bring something to the table that we can look at and say, yep, that sounds reasonable. Of course, everything's subject to change, but at least sounds reasonable and we know, you know, what actions and what deliverables we have. Okay.
So we'll send that up before. So the discussion was very helpful. Getting it together.
Anything else from anyone?
Not on this. I've got staff people. So. Ann will kill me for this. And that is here somewhere. Glenn sent out an email to you, and I think mentioned both those things. One is the ABA conference in October, and one of the how many people are interested in going to that. It's impressive view of the place to go. City will pick up the registration. You're going to find a place to stay.
Wait, what? Sorry. 2 years ago, they paid for everything. A few years ago, cheapskates.
Well, there have been times when we have done that, but we're in a position to do that. And the other one is a conference in Fort Collins, the Downtown Colorado Inc. conference, which always looks like it's really good information. Mm-hmm. It'd be fun to be in that, in the forum of Fort Collins, I think, thinking about things, because there are a lot of things there that we could use and think about, and that'd be appropriate for people as well. They've been very successful in the downtown, very successful in some of the aligning areas as well.
Is
It's in the Viking brewery tour that they're going to do.
The brewery tour would be very nice.
So I'm planning on going to that one. I have to, I'll get to you, Anne, this week of what days. I don't know that I'll be able to go for the full 3 days. I just have to get some schedules coordinated.
Did you say the days for the Fort Collins one? I didn't.
It was September.
They were in September 9th through 12th.
Yeah. So like Wednesday through Friday.
Actually, it says Tuesday through Friday. So with that, usually those are Tuesday nights.
Check in time. I had a couple of things. In regards to our study sessions, if we're going to have public input, are we should decide on whether we're going to have it at every study session, how long it would last, and put it on the agenda so that we know it's there.
Okay.
And then about taking public testimony before we have a case to see, didn't we have training that said we should not hear public testimony before we have a case in front of us? So it wouldn't be an opportunity for someone to stand up in front of this study session and talk about something that might be coming down the road for a case. Am I understanding that correctly? So if you have that, or if Randy is chair, then we should have some rules for we're not hearing that now. Or at least let the public know what they can and cannot talk about if we're going to take public testimony at a study session.
Yep.
And you can talk generally about issues, but you can't talk about this.
Specifics on a thing. And then one other thing on iAnnotate. Are we going to do another training?
I'm working with Wendy right now to schedule that. It'll probably be either of a study session or a regular meeting.
At Del Frisco's?
There we go.
Okay.
Actually, there was another question about a study session with council on the 12th that Glenn sent out. Or maybe I have.
Yes, tentatively for August 12th. Schedules to determine if the state works and let Anne know if it works or doesn't work. And let Glenn and Anne know any topics you think you want to present and discuss with council.
Oh, there's no topics for this yet?
So what was the trigger? What was the trigger of the study session? Was there a trigger, or was it just hey, let's meet every 6 months?
They want to do 2 a year with each board. So okay. I think that's probably what's doing the August. But they're open to hearing what you want discussion items.
What was discussed at the last? When was the last one?
In January, I think.
And we discussed the citywide plan?
Yes.
I think we were still doing the comprehensive.
I think it's when we got the direction.
No, I was just echoing.
I can't make it August 12th.
Anybody else know if they can't either? I will not be anything either. I'll be in Boston at the else?
I love coming to those meetings.
You'll cancel everything else, dude.
Get everything off my schedule for me.
Dee, you're up.
And so our next meeting, we're still on, so even if nothing is being presented, it will be a study session, okay? And then just to be able to follow up, did everyone receive the email that was forwarded from Randy about his request and concerns about making sure we do continue to have meetings? Me, I think today was very beneficial. I mean, it definitely helped that we even had things to look through. But I do agree with Randy that we should continue to do that, and it sounds like everybody else does too. Okay. As far as visiting neighborhoods, I think we should all do that. I don't think it necessarily should be asked of us. But I do think that, if you have the opportunity, linger a little bit more in some neighborhoods that you don't know, myself included in that. But I do think one of the things we'll need to do as we go through this process a little bit more is put some structure to it. Because, again, if I come in and say, blah, 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 and somebody else says, how do you bring all that information together into something that's useful as opposed to, again, more data that isn't structured in any way and then just creates inefficiencies in the process?
Well, the other thing we can think about, too, if you guys want to do a tour collectively that we can host, we could actually take
That's a good idea.
Everybody's in the same place. You have the discussion on the van can or on the bus or whatever. It's a little problematic in terms of public notice, and so we probably have to have spots where we stop and let people know where we're going to stop and discuss or something like that.
That's a great idea.
I have to talk to Kristen to be able to do that. It can be very valuable.
Can we? Can we plan on that? I mean, how do we plan on that? We can talk about it offline, but...
Yeah, and as we can determine what our schedule is, which we will get, which day we're
going to
do the grand tour of all of them initially. It's a lot to do.
I'd like to be able to look at one or a small group and kind of get an idea of how we discuss that, mm-hmm. rather than trying to... I'm not smart enough to deal with 12 things at once like that. I need to be able to focus on a small
thing. I think group. It helps to actually get out and walk and find out what the issues are there.
Especially if it would be helpful for me, at least, and I don't know, maybe it goes a different direction, but the way I was thinking about it is you were looking at a corridor, part of a corridor, and the two or three neighborhoods that overlap. You could look at those at the same time. You know, it might make sense, even if Stern Park, say, is low priority, if there's a high priority corridor and or neighborhood, we do them all together.
Okay. All right. Great. Okay. Meeting adjourned.